Thank you, Melissa. Thank you all for being here, especially thank you, Meghan, for joining us tonight. This book came out early October, and so Meghan has been on book tour ever since, and we are the end of the tour. So
save the best for last.
Yeah, hopefully. But we're delighted that you're here and willing to do one more stop to celebrate the publication of this fine collection, Interior States. To set the stage a little bit for tonight's discussion, I wanted to go back to Meghan and my getting to know one another. So I first heard of her shortly after I had published a piece in The Point magazine and was in conversation with the editor there who, as we were getting to know one another, said something about, "You're really gonna find this essay we're working on by Meghan O'Gieblyn really interesting." So I heard this name, and then I started reading this person, and have since had the good pleasure of becoming friends with her and her husband, Barrett, to discover that what's behind the resume, being a graduate of this university in the MFA program in creative nonfiction and becoming a writer of real remarkable gifts, is just a really wonderful person. And so it's been really great to get to know you, Meghan, in that capacity. Now, blurbs on books are trying to sell books, and I don't mean to embarrass you here, Meghan, but some might say comparisons with Joan Didion are a little bit over the top. Like Meghan might say that it's a little bit over the top, but I don't think so. I mean, there's time, right? But really, the depth and range that Meghan brings to her work is really remarkable. And so we'll get into that in some discussion. But before we do, one of the reasons we became friends, I think, in the way we did, is we could look at our respective lives and find many areas of overlap. So last Friday, when we were getting together to discuss this evening, we just started creating a list. And this is what it looks like. Raised in what would be characterized as evangelical homes, check. Raised in the Midwest, check. Homeschooled, check. Kind of became confidently independent learners, check. Went to what would be characterized as evangelical Christian colleges, check. Heavily influenced in college by philosophy of existentialism, check. Heavily influenced by reading the Brothers Karamazov, check. Went to grad school and decided to become writers, check. Then started writing for places like the Boston Review, LA Review, and perhaps most notably in the area of personal overlap, The Point magazine. And now we live in Madison, check. So this could go on and on and on. And we even realized today there was one thing we didn't discuss, which was having both been sort of the active participants in multiple altar calls. So we can check
just to be safe.
Yeah, just to be safe. Just in case there was any risk that between the last one and the one you were present for, that you just cover your bases. So there's another check on the list. So that we have so many things in common to the point that if at one point we just start joking around up here, somebody, you know, tap us and we'll try to stop. But I want to get into the book. Instead of asking Meghan to read from this section of the opening essay, Dispatch from Flyover Country, I thought I would read a short selection to give you a sense of the flavor that I have come to so deeply admire in her work. The Midwest is a somewhat slippery notion. It is a region whose existence, whose very name has always been contingent upon the more fixed and concrete notion of the West. Historically, these interior states were less a destination than a corridor, one that funneled travelers from the East into the vast expanse of the frontier. The great industrial cities of this region, Chicago, Detroit, and St. Louis, were built as hubs, places where the rivers and the railroads met, where all the goods of the prairie accumulated before being shipped to the exterior states. Today, coastal residents stop here, only to change planes, a fact that has solidified our identity as a place to be passed over. To be fair, people who live here seem to prefer it this way. Gift shops along the shores of the Great Lakes sell t-shirts bearing the slogan, "Flyover Living." The official motto of the state of Indiana is Crossroads of America. Each time my family passed the state line on childhood road trips, my sisters and I would mock its odd, anti-touristic logic. Nothing to see here, folks.
So, can I add one funny thing there?
Yes.
I was just reading in Nebraska, and I heard that they just changed their state motto to, "It's not for everyone." This is literally their state motto, so I wish I had known this when I was writing the essay. It's a better example.
And if I could add one anecdote to that, when we spoke on the phone last week, when Meghan was referring to her reading up Nebraska to North Dakota and so on, she referred to it as being out west. So just
does feel like out west.
Now, just one sentence to conclude, and then I want to ask you a question. This is just a jump down the page. It's difficult to live here without developing an existential dizziness, a sense that the rest of the world is moving while you remain still. Sort of a chilling thought. But before we get maybe into that thought in particular, I just wanted to know, at what point did you realize you were from the Midwest?
Very late. I think maybe when I was writing this essay, in a way. And I think that in many ways, is like the most typical Midwestern experience, is having this sense that you are from nowhere in particular. And I think that's sort of, in a way, the legacy of the Midwest, this idea that you're, that this is sort of this like typical average. Is this echoing or is this okay? Am I just hearing it?
No, I think you're fine.
Okay.
Mine might be a little goofy.
Yeah. No, but yeah, just the sense that that the Midwest is sort of this nowhere zone. And so I guess I didn't really think, I wrote this essay around 2015, around a time when I had moved, my husband and I met here in Madison and got married here, and we moved back to Muskegon, Michigan, which is a small town where I spent a lot of my childhood. And I guess that was really something about that move made me start thinking about the Midwest and what it means to live in this region. And I think I was also coming to terms with the fact that I wasn't going to leave. You know, I'd turned 30, and I think I had always sort of thought like, oh, I'm going to go somewhere else eventually, to New York or California or somewhere more glamorous maybe. So this essay grew out of that realization that this is somewhere in particular, and what does it mean to live here? What is the identity of this place? And this passage that you read, I feel like is really influenced by, I was rereading around the time I started writing this essay, I was rereading William Cronin's History of the Midwest, Nature's Metropolis, which is actually, it's a history of Chicago and sort of its role in the frontier. And he talks about how Chicago and the Midwest to some extent was this gateway to the frontier, that it's always been a corridor of some sorts. And you know, this idea that the major cities of the region were hubs. And you know, today we have this term flyover country, which somebody, I forget who it was, a lexicographer I think, who said that term flyover country is a stereotype about other people's stereotypes, right? This idea that we are sort of stereotyping how coastal residents see us. But I think there is some truth to that idea that this is a place of fluidity. I guess when I was starting to write the essay, I just had this image, the very vague image in my mind of the Midwest as being this sort of like vortex, this whirlpool. Mm-hmm. It's a place that's not geographically a destination, but this place of transit and things moving through. And I think I was interested particularly in that as sort of a philosophical idea, you know, and how I talk later in the essay about, you know, friends of ours who've moved to California and are very like involved in the tech industry there, and they come back to visit and they have these like very techno-utopian views about the future.
Yeah.
And the sense that history itself has a destination, right? And this idea that we're all, you know, sort of this, almost this Christian messianic view of history. And I think in the Midwest, there's sort of a stoicism toward those narratives. Stoicism, not just as an affect, but almost like the old Stoic view of history being cyclical.
Right.
And sort of a little bit of skepticism toward those utopian visions of progress. Yeah.
Yeah, so to land specifically in your current place, mm-hmm. Do you mind reading from later in the essay where your stoicism and skepticism sort of
emerges
again?
Yeah, so this is a section about Madison, Wisconsin.
About here.
Yeah, I guess to preface this, I have a section about Madison in here, and I talk about how there's certain places in the Midwest that are considered oases, or places that sort of are within the region, but they don't technically belong there. And they usually have special names to designate them as such. So Madison is known as the Berkeley of the Midwest, right? So sort of this idea that it's more of a West Coast mentality. So I write about that.
I've heard Boulder is called the Madison of the Mountains. That's what I've
really
heard Boulder called.
I had somebody who wrote to me who had read the book from Berkeley, and he said, I think that Berkeley should be the Madison of the West Coast.
Oh, there you go. See? There you go.
Yeah. So maybe we could insist on that. Okay, so I say Madison was utopia for a certain kind of Midwesterner, the Baptist boy who grew up reading Wittgenstein, the farm lass who secretly dreamed about the girl next door. It should have been such a place for me as well. Instead, I came to find the live bluegrass outside the co-op insufferable. I developed a physical allergy to NPR. Sitting in a bakery one morning, I heard the opening theme of Morning Edition drift in from the kitchen and started scratching my arms as though contracting a rash. My husband tried to get me to articulate what it was that bothered me, but I could never come up with the right adjective. Self-satisfied? Self-congratulatory? I could never get past aesthetics. On the way home from teaching my night class, I would unwind by listening to a fundamentalist preacher who delivered exegesis on the Pentateuch and occasionally lapsed into fire and brimstone. The drive was long, and I would slip into something like a trance state, failing to register the import of the message, but calmed nonetheless by the familiar rhythm of conviction. Over time, I came to dread the parties. Most of the people we knew had spent time on the coasts, or had come from there, or were frequently traveling from one to the other, and the conversation was always about what was happening elsewhere, what people were listening to in Williamsburg, or what everyone was wearing at Coachella. A sizable portion of the evening was devoted to the plots of premium TV dramas. Occasionally, there were long arguments about actual ideas, but they always crumbled into semantics. What do you mean by duty? Someone would say. Or, it all depends on your definition of morality. At the end of these nights, I would get into the car with the first throb of a migraine, saying that we didn't have any business discussing anything until we could all of us articulate a coherent ideology. It seemed to me that we suffered from the fundamental delusion that we had elevated ourselves above the rubble of hinterland ignorance, that fair trade coffee and orange you glad it's vegan cake had somehow redeemed us of our sins. All of us had, like the man in the parable, built our houses on sand. That's the end of the section.
Yes. Goodness gracious. I've read it dozens of times in the last couple days, but hearing it's even better. You can hear just the intellectual depth and the spiritual sensibilities and the biblical poetics and aesthetics that you sort of weave into your work. And there's also something, I was trying to come up with a phrase to characterize, like if I could say in just one phrase what you embody in your work, it's like, this gentle ferocity. Oh. You have like this ferocious capacity to just engage whatever your subject is, but there's such gentleness with it which comes through there. And of the many areas of overlap we described, I kind of know some of the answer to this, but what made you become this kind of thinker and writer? What contributes mostly to this gentle ferocity of yours?
I don't know. I guess I always feel like my aesthetic or my voice as an essayist was informed by sermons, probably growing up. Mm-hmm. I think maybe that's where the ferocity, if that's what you want to call it, comes from. This, I think, I write in the preface that every every piece that I'm writing, there's an argument in there, even if it's not explicit. I think that's sort of what drives me to write essays, is to make an argument. And sometimes it's making an explicit point, or sometimes it's merely correcting premises. You know, so I think this piece about the Midwest maybe grew out of the desire to correct certain stereotypes about the Midwest, and to, you know, show that it's more complex and maybe more useful as an idea than it's often made to seem.
Yeah.
So, and like, this is a piece where it's mostly narrative and it's a lot of just scenes and observations, mm-hmm. and maybe it doesn't feel like there's an argument there, but to me it was important that there was, and
yeah.
I think that informs it.
Yeah.
And maybe the submersion of the argument is what it makes it feel more implicit or more...
Well, and there's also that interesting moment where you refer to the listening to the sermons, right?
Mm-hmm.
This experience, this calming, therapeutic experience, and you called it a familiar rhythm of conviction. And what occurred to me when you were reading it was the question, as compared to what?
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, as compared to NPR, I guess.
Yeah.
Which is, it's so funny, because now that this book is out, I've been on like 4 different public radio stations, and they, without fail, always ask me about that line, and I feel so awful, because I listen to public radio every morning, and I have to assure them that I'm not a anti-public radio person. And I think something that I wish had come through maybe a little bit more strong in this section particularly is that I'm implicating myself in this worldview. You know, I've lived in Madison now for about eight years, excluding the year that we moved back to Michigan. And I feel very comfortable here. You know, I went to graduate school here, and I still go to the co-op and listen to the bluegrass music. And but I think there's like some latent fundamentalist in me, maybe, that I'm very aware of what I guess you would call like liberal pieties, which I think is, you know, sort of typicalized by NPR, or this idea that there is, I think particularly in places like Madison, there's sort of a secular morality or a secular piety.
Yeah.
That I'm a little bit skeptical of, because I, you know, grew up in a religious environment where all of that stemmed from this sort of foundational worldview. You know, that we had the authority of scripture and we believe these things because of this. And I think a lot of, people, you know, on, I guess, like the secular left, you know, we have sort of these pieties and these moralities, and then if you ask people what it comes from, it's sort of these vague, oh, well, we believe in liberalism or openness.
Yeah. Yeah.
But what does that actually mean? If you actually try to interrogate those things, people have a difficult time articulating it. And I think that
people are generally good.
Yeah, right. And I find that in myself too. Like, it's difficult for me to articulate those things.
Right.
And I think there is something comforting about that external authority, like listening to the preachers.
Yeah.
I really do find it, you know, I still tune into the Christian radio station. And I was thinking about this the other day. There's that, going back to Dostoevsky, that quote from, I think, the Brothers Karamazov, where he says, well, if God didn't exist, everything is permitted,
mm-hmm.
right? And
yeah.
I think Lacan famously inverted that and said, no, if God doesn't exist, then everything is prohibited.
Right.
Because the idea is that your superego then, if you don't have this external authority,
right.
your superego kind of goes berserk,
right.
and creates all these other pseudo limits.
Yeah.
And so you do have all these sort of secular religions of people, you know, whether it's, you know, coming out in sort of an ecological worldview or political correctness, or people, you know, using technology and science as a kind of religion.
Yeah.
And that's something I'm really interested in, and something I kind of return to, I think, a lot of my essays.
Alan Jacobs calls it the imposition of the cognitive load.
Oh, yeah.
Absent any sort of like spiritual anchoring point, what you have is reason, and
mm-hmm.
we're not sufficient to actually carry that cognitive load.
Yeah,
is what
we retreat from it into rules and all sorts of,
Yes. So let's stay in the Midwest.
Yeah.
Shifting from that sort of broad evaluation of the Midwest to a particular place you know very well, which is Michigan.
Mm-hmm.
And in your essay, Pure Michigan, what I found so striking was, one, just your ability to capture the natural beauty. But again, the way you do that with such spiritual depth and sensibility is so striking to me. So I wonder if you could read from the section we talked about in Pure Michigan, mm-hmm. 170.
Yeah, so this is the opening.
Yeah.
Of this essay, okay.
Yeah.
If you live anywhere along the wide swath of the Rust Belt, you've probably seen the television spots. There are a dozen or so variants, but each ad begins in the same manner, with cinematic piano music and sweeping aerial shots of lighthouses and crashing waves. They show beaches of unblemished Kalkaska sand and kids cannonballing off floating docks. The narration is reminiscent of the copy found in certain resort brochures in that it seeks not merely to describe the locale but to evoke an entire experience. The perfect summer has a voice, begins one. It whispers one more game, one more swim, one more round. The ads are paid for by Travel Michigan, a division of the state's Economic Development Corporation, and end always with the tagline, Pure Michigan. About a year ago, my husband and I, who have spent most of our adult lives in the major cities of the Midwest, moved to Muskegon, a small town on the western coast of the Lower Peninsula. The ads, which air regularly in Milwaukee, Cincinnati, Indianapolis, and Chicago, air here too. I suppose they're trying to reach people who are passing through, or maybe the ads are meant for us, the residents, as a morale boost of sorts, a reminder that life here is good. Muskegon is an old lumber town whose economic telos ended the day Chicago discovered steel, but it has persisted through several recessions and decades of industrial decline. I grew up here, and my husband and I moved here to be closer to family, though I suppose we were also drawn by the prospect of clean air and solitude, of freshwater swims along the eerie Galapagos-like stillness of deserted beaches. On some mornings in early summer, the shallows along the shoreline are like glass, the water so clear it looks chlorinated. While the Pure Michigan ads pay homage to places all over the state, a great deal of the footage features the western shoreline of Lake Michigan, from St. Joseph all the way up to the Upper Peninsula. There are shots of canoes traversing the oceanic blue coastline along Sleeping Bear Dunes, and of anglers roll casting in shaded tributaries. The ads clearly convey that this is a place of water, and the water is, as the tagline suggests, pure. Water, a deep male voice intones. We take our showers with it, we make our coffee with it, but we rarely tap its true potential and just let it be itself, flowing freely into clean lakes, clear streams, and along more freshwater coastline than any other state in the country. It's not impossible to imagine the voice coupled with the aerial shots as belonging to God himself. It's actually the voice of Tim Allen. You guys have seen the Pure Michigan ads, right? I think they air here too on the radio and on TV. Yeah.
Tim the Tool Man Taylor.
Tim the Tool Man. Yeah.
So from the voice of God, let's as you said, there's always an argument, and I'll ask you what the argument is, and maybe that can then fill out the next section we chose, that is the conclusion of the essay. But you really sort of set this beautiful bucolic description up against a really sort of bleak and devastating set of realities.
Yeah, so the ads, if you've seen them, they're incredibly beautiful ads. I think they're the most successful tourism ads in Michigan's history. They made like 7 times the amount of money that's been put into them back in tourist revenue.
And what was the previous?
Say yes to Michigan.
Right, that's right.
Which is like so 1970s, right. Like the state's like a proposition to put on the ballot or something. But yeah, so the Pure Michigan ads are you know, these beautiful shots of, and like I mentioned in that excerpt, many of them are about the purity of Michigan's water. I moved back to Michigan with my husband, I think it was around the time of the Flint water crisis. And they were playing these Pure Michigan ads during the commercial breaks of the news coverage of the Flint crisis, talking about the purity of Michigan's water.
Right.
And there was just, I was like, who's doing the programming? Like, no sense of awareness or irony. It was almost this like Orwellian, ad experience. So I started thinking about that and what that means, and I think the William Cronin book made its way into this too, because he actually talks about, and I think this is something that goes back, you know, throughout from the earliest 20th century, is that there's always been this notion of two Midwests. There's sort of this bucolic, pastoral Midwest that you find in, say, Grant Wood paintings, you know, this sort of romantic, warm center of America, and is still evoked occasionally in things like these Pure Michigan ads or in these evocations of the heartland, you know. And then there's the Gothic, I would call it, sort of this where you see, you know, I guess maybe early version, I don't know if you call it Gothic, but sort of this darker view of the Midwest that's in like Sinclair Lewis or Eggerly Masters, Moon River anthology of sort of these small desiccated towns that are full of, you know, like moralism and small-minded people. And then, you know, as the industrial cities were built up in a lot of like Hamlin Garland novels and Frank Norris, you have these stories about the young person from the fields of Wisconsin who's coming to the big city and they're taking the train into Chicago and there's this hellscape of industry and smog and dirt. And I think that vision of the Midwest has really persisted, particularly in the post-industrial era, where you have this like Detroit ruin porn, you know, and sort of this idea that the Midwest is this gothic, repressed, abject, sort of the place that history forgot. And I think we're always sort of toggling. If you look at, you know, narratives in the national media about the Midwest, it's we're always toggling between those two views. And there's no sense of interconnectedness, the idea that this is the same region and that these problems, you know, are connected to places like Muskegon that's supposedly, you know, a tourist destination.
Yeah, and you draw this tension out further in a way that, one, the success of the campaign requires disconnectedness. But then you have this remarkable moment where, is it a friend or just an acquaintance who's in her apartment in Chicago, watching the ads, right?
Being really homesick for Michigan.
Right.
Yeah.
And so she literally is sitting at her computer watching multiple, like 30 minutes worth of ads, crying.
Yeah.
Right.
Because she has this very
sad
corporate life in Chicago, and was like living in a basement apartment and like commuting all day. And
right.
Yeah, so even within the Midwest, there's this sort of like almost like nostalgia for this view of the Midwest, which doesn't really exist,
right,
but is an ideal of some kind.
Yeah, and somehow that, like, again, the disconnect is in the reality of the conditions, right, of the way people live.
Yeah.
But then there's this profound moment of connection that you illustrate through the ad campaign.
Yeah.
Right? But then it concludes. And so I was wondering if you could read from the last section of that essay.
Just where the last two paragraphs?
Starting on, what is it?
Oh,
page
on 175.
175
maybe.
Or 6. I can't remember exactly. Let's see.
Yeah, okay. So I think I'm talking about the myth here, the idea that the world can be divided into places that are.
Oh, yeah.
Just
the last. So you've described at great length the environmental devastation, right?
Uh-huh.
And the, again, the concrete realities of what's going on in the state of Michigan. And then you come back to sort of conclude and reflect on the ads.
Yeah. So, I think this idea that there's like the, I refer in this first sentence to the myth, which is just the myth that you can escape from modernity, basically, into these wilderness purity areas. To believe in this myth, though, is to ignore the actual extent to which human activity reshapes the natural world. The Great Lakes, which provide drinking water to more than 40 million people, are hardly wellsprings of purity. Over the past decade, loopholes in the Clean Water Act have turned the waters of Lake Michigan into what one environmental report referred to as a witch's brew of pollutants. Temperatures in the Great Lakes have been warming since the late 1990s, and environmentalists predict lower water levels, drought, and a decline in biodiversity. There was a time when I loved the Pure Michigan ads because they mirrored the way the terrain of my childhood existed in my imagination. But when you live here year-round, it's difficult to sustain the illusion. You begin to notice things, the frequent beach closings due to E. coli, the toxic algae blooms that marbleize the shallows of the lake with neon green foam. When I was a child, Lake Michigan would freeze each winter far into the perceivable distance. The ice covered more than half the lake and was thick enough that you could walk for miles toward the horizon, from which vantage the entire Earth resembled the tundra of Antarctica or the surface of the moon. This past winter, only a thin lip of ice extended over the shoreline and was gone by early February. Unlike the scandals in Flint and Detroit, which can be pinned on corruption and corporate greed, reports about drought and dead zones point to no clear villain. It's difficult to read about them without feeling implicated. Still, the observable fluctuations are subtle, and it's easy to dismiss them as the product of El Nino or the meteorological fickleness that has always characterized this part of the country. As summer approaches, there are still days when the landscape resembles the image of itself reflected in the Pure Michigan ads, when sunrise finds the beaches empty and the water along the shoreline a serene and crystalline blue. In the light of a glorious morning, it's tempting to believe that this is a place set apart, that the water itself is redemptive, that it will make us clean.
She's good. Again, your ability to sort of capture and harness this biblical aesthetic in the same conversation as recognizing and describing environmental devastation is so powerful. And so we'll talk about faith a bit here, because it clearly influences you. But of the areas of overlap that I described earlier, we've sort of landed at different places in our life and in what we sort of ascribe meaning to in some ways. And so I wonder if, before we get into the specifics of that and some sections to read from, you could just describe a little bit about your upbringing and, and the religious components of it.
Yeah, so I grew up in an evangelical home. We were like Baptists, and then we sort of switched to non-denominational in the 90s, which I think is sort of what a lot of people did. Robert mentioned I was homeschooled up until 10th grade, so I did have a very, I would say, insular, sheltered childhood in many ways. Most of the people we knew were from church, so most of the people that I was friends with sort of believed the same thing that I did. I went to Moody Bible Institute for 2 years when I was 18 and studied theology, and kind of had plans to become a missionary, and then ended up having a faith crisis while I was there. And I ended up leaving Moody and then went through several years of struggling kind of back and forth. I don't know what I believe, and going back and reading, you know, a lot of theology and then also reading a lot of secular philosophy and existentialism and trying to find sort of an alternate worldview. And I ultimately left the faith and identified for a while as an atheist. I would say I'm more agnostic today. But then unexpectedly, like in my late 20s, started writing about Christianity and realized that I had never really had any closure, I think, on those both the personal aspect, like why I left, and then also some of the theological questions that I had been struggling with. So this book really grew out of the experience of revisiting that part of my life and trying to make sense of it.
Yeah, and so as I was, prepping, one of the things we discussed last week is like, well, how do you describe yourself? Because some people would clearly describe you as an atheist. Some people would probably want to hold on to you and say, no, she's a Christian.
Yeah.
But it felt like the thing you were most comfortable with was spiritually confused.
Yeah. I'm fine with that, yeah.
Right. And so I think drawing on that, the way I was trying to get my mind around this is there would be a way to read your book and the essays that aren't in this book as tragedies, right? And maybe, you know, people who are Christians and adamantly so would want to read them as tragedies. There would be people who would be on the other side of the spectrum who might want to read them as comedies, like, see? Right? But I always find myself reading your work as just a pure drama. It's neither one. It's mm-hmm. it's a pure drama, and I think of you as speaking in the voice of a pure and true pilgrim, like really seeking. I mean, you're mm-hmm. truly seeking in the way that's admirable. So, and I think exemplary for anyone, and certainly Christians. So, on that note, I'm wondering if we could go to one of your pilgrimages.
Oh yeah.
Which is to the Creation Museum. And if you could read from that, and then maybe we can talk about this. In fact, before, I think because the section we pinned down doesn't provide enough context, maybe you could just say a little bit about the Creation Museum itself for those who don't know about it, you know, its founder and purpose and so forth.
So the Creation Museum was built, I believe, in 2007. It's relatively new in northern Kentucky, and it's a museum that is completely devoted to defending young earth creationism. So the idea that...
Which I need to qualify. When I say a pilgrimage, I don't mean into that place of defense. I just want to make sure.
Into the place of what?
You weren't a pilgrim seeking out fulfillment in that purpose of the museum.
To find out if creationism is true.
But just in the general sense of going on a journey, you were, yes.
Well, yeah, I guess I should tell the backstory about why I went there. So I grew up, like, basically, I mean, because we were homeschooled, so most of our textbooks taught young earth creationism. And it was sort of a worldview, I guess, I just took for granted, you know, up until, and even at Moody, a lot of our professors were, you know, yes, this is the only way to read the Bible, that it was created in, the world was created in 6 days, 6,000 years ago, and so, anyway, but the museum seemed like something new, in that it was this major production. I think it was like $27 million went into building this place, and the production quality is actually quite high. They got animatronic engineers from like Disney and Mattel to do, you know, the exhibits, and it's very so the guy who created the museum is Ken Ham. He's an Australian I want to say theologian. I don't know what he's, I don't think he's a scientist.
I don't know what we would call Ken.
I'm not sure.
That's another area of overlap we could have put on the checklist. But, know who Ken Ham is. Check.
Yeah. But my family had been to it. All my family's still in the church, and they had been to it several times, and we're kind of like talking very highly of it, and I was just kind of baffled by the idea that there was a museum devoted to this, and so I kind of went to check it out.
Yeah.
And I went with my husband Barrett, and
who plays prominently in a number of
character.
These essays. This one, he is he's one of my heroes of the essay, I will say.
Yeah. So we took an excursion. We went down to Kentucky and visited the museum. So yeah, should I just read this section?
Yeah, that'd be great. Okay. 76 and 77?
Yeah. Okay. As I browse the exhibits, it becomes clear that in the decades since I was a kid, creationists have evolved into a more sophisticated species, particularly in their efforts to reconcile scripture with empirical, observable evidence. Their methods are far from scientific, but there's a willingness to compete with legitimate science that wasn't present in the past. It's not so much anti-intellectualism as it is intellectualism conceived on another planet, by scientists stoned on hallucinogens watching reruns of Carl Sagan's Cosmos. Creationists now have their own research institutes and their own peer-reviewed journals that featured articles like Emergentism, and this is actually a title of a real article, Emergentism and the Rejection of Spirit Entities, a Response to Christian Physicalists. As someone who grew up immersed in creationism, I never thought about whether it was an attractive worldview. It was simply the truth. Ironically, it was only after I stopped believing in God, for unrelated reasons, that I began to regard creationism as a deeply seductive belief system. After I left the faith, I read Richard Feynman and Stephen Jay Gould, and as I confronted the specter of a universe determined by phenomena as bizarre as virtual particles and Boltzmann brains, I often felt a pang of nostalgia for the elegance of the Genesis narrative. The truth is that even when it's dressed up in pseudoscientific jargon, creationism's appeal lies in its delicious simplicity. It presents the kind of tidy framework physicists dream about, a unified theory of everything, and one that hasn't been revised in 6,000 years. By the time I got around to the books of Brian Greene, by contrast, people were already debating whether string theory had been debunked by the Large Hadron Collider. Real science is mind-boggling complex and beginning to sound more and more like science fiction, multiverses, spiritual machines. The pressing questions about the origins of the universe have moved from the realm of biology, which is user-friendly and fun, to that of physics, which is arcane and counterintuitive. And this shift is coinciding, at least in this country, with a shortening attention span at a time when truth often gets confused with the most pithy soundbite. Creationism, which relies on oversimplified passionate appeals to common sense, might actually have an adaptive edge in this climate.
Yeah, and so one of the things that you begin to feel when, maybe I've said this already, but you certainly begin to feel in essays like this, is your prophetic voice. Mm-hmm. Meghan's using language that's now become commonplace, but this was written 4 years ago, before we supposedly entered the post-truth era. And so that's just one striking thing about this essay. And to my sort of suggestion that there's a way of tragically reading these essays or a way of comically reading these essays, I wonder if we could sort of go to your, what I take to be your dramatic conclusion,
mm-hmm.
and finish the thought, you know, follow it through. I don't know if there are pieces you want to fill in.
Yeah, maybe I should fill in. I guess, so I had, this is like not the first journalistic piece that's been written about the Creation Museum. It's kind of become this trope for like secular journalists to go there and write this like very dismissive, very patronizing piece about, oh, look at all these like crazy fundamentalists and all
right.
the women in their long dresses who are there and like how stupid these people are. And I obviously, I knew when I was going there that I didn't want to take like the cheap pot shots. Like I said, this is a worldview that I know from the inside. But I also noticed that like creationism and sort of this approach to Christianity had changed pretty dramatically since I was a child, that there was this sort of idea that they could create their own, that they could compete with science somehow or take science on its own terms. And the thing that maybe one moment to mention that's important earlier is there was this moment where I went to this like information session where Ken Ham was actually there. This is part of the reason I went.
Yeah,
was
yeah.
He was there to talk about this new Ark, Noah's Ark project that's now part of the museum also. And he was talking about, he was like, went in this riff for a long time about postmodern relativism and how,
mm-hmm, right.
you know, nobody, like, everybody is, you know, attacking the legitimacy of scripture and, you know, the Bible isn't this authority that it used to be anymore. And then, in a later note, he kind of talked about how great of a production team he had and how well put together the museum was. And as a way of bragging about his design team, he said, you know, we had a secular journalist who came here and wrote up a piece about the museum, and he went back and said, that place is so well done
right.
that kids are going to go there and they're going to believe it. And the whole crowd at that moment started cheering and clapping. And it was so bizarre because they weren't clapping for the truth of the Bible. They were clapping for the production quality.
It's persuasion. Yeah,
yeah
it's
that it was persuasive,
persuade.
Almost as if they were admitting that the validity of their worldview depended on its presentation.
And that it required this major apparatus.
Right.
Right.
And this is really Ken Ham's brilliance, is that he, I mean, brilliance in a certain way, is that he realized that these same forces, like postmodernism, that had been attacking the authority of scripture, that he could use this to attack the authority of science and say,
right.
well, that's just, you know, their view, that's just an opinion. We have our own facts. We have our own worldview.
Right.
And again, yeah, you see this a lot, I think, on the Christian right these days politically, too. But
yeah.
Yeah, so this conclusion is kind of, hopefully that puts that a little bit more in context. Yeah, okay. Ken is fond of ranting against the evils of postmodern relativism, where opinion carries more weight than fact, and all evidence is subject to interpretation. Yet this is precisely the environment that allows pre-Enlightenment thinking like creationism to thrive. If Ken Ham's worldview is considered a viable product in the marketplace of ideas, it's because ours is a culture that has lost faith in objective authority, one where opinions are swayed not by the integrity of the argument, but by the pyrotechnics of its presentation. When I was a kid, the church saw itself in opposition to this sort of relativism, an island amid a sea of shifting truths. And I suppose that in coming to the Creation Museum, the backwater fringe of evangelicalism, I'd expected to find some remnant of this older, near extinct form of Christianity, one unconcerned with passing fashions, one that was secure in the mysteries of Scripture. Instead, I found the church's latest attempt to bewitch unbelievers with glitzy, multi-million-dollar productions. Evangelicals like to claim that theirs is a religion of immutable absolutes. And yet attractions like the Ark Encounter belie the church's increasing willingness to engage in the kind of market-driven natural selection that increasingly determines truth in our culture. Call it the survival of the slickest. It's a worldview that precludes the very possibility of inconvenient truths. And I have a narrative ending, but do you want me to read the final paragraph?
Yeah.
Okay, so this is as we're leaving the Creation Museum. As we head north, I roll down the windows. The sky has gone black, and the air possesses the damp coolness of the hours that precede a storm. But as we continue our drive home, the sky clears, and night falls, and days pass before the rain finally comes.
So we grew up at a time where I feel like it became a mantra of sorts that you would hear, whether it was just in passing conversation or in a college course or something. Everyone has their own truth, right? I mean, this was a very popular idea that was taking sort of, commonplace shape in the 90s.
Mm-hmm.
But you're problematizing that notion,
mm-hmm.
right? And so, well, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that was a big thing in the 90s that we were warned as I would say, maybe I heard the term postmodern relativism for the first time when I was 10 or 11 years old.
Right.
They're preparing us for when we went to college.
Right.
Right. If we went to a liberal university, that we'd be taught like Foucault and Derrida and stuff.
Yeah.
And also this idea that I think there was a sense that it had already been trickling down into the culture, that if you turned on MTV, you were going to be taught postmodern relativism. I grew up with this strong sense that there has to be some, that there is this foundational authority that you could appeal to. Now maybe I guess it has fully sort of that idea, I guess you could say post-structuralism has kind of fully infiltrated the culture.
To the extent that those who were warning against it
mm-hmm.
are now employing it.
Are now employing it to their, they realize they could use it to their benefit.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah, and so, which in some worldview, I guess makes sense that like that's how you survive in this culture, and that's what people have decided to do. I don't know. It is like what would have happened if the church had instead insisted on this idea of authority and absolutes, because you do undermine your own, the tenets of your own belief. System
right.
Once you
enter the survival of the slickest.
Right, right. Mm-hmm.
Which is a great phrase. This is one of many examples for me in the book, and please don't fail to leave without a copy. That demonstrates, I didn't really put it together until I read the essays in a collected way, how much you use the word seduction.
Oh, really?
And seductive.
Yeah. As somebody else pointed out, I use the word anachronistic in almost every one of my essays, too. This is like the horror of having all your work collected and people reading it in one place.
It's yes.
Like all my weird obsessions.
But yours is a resistance to those seductions.
Mm.
You just refuse to be seduced by intellectual and spiritual hucksters.
Hmm. Well, I do. I mean, the reason I'm writing about these things is I do find them seductive, though.
Right, I know.
Yes. And I'm very skeptical of them for that reason, maybe. Because I understand their appeal. Yeah.
Yes. So you simultaneously understand their appeal, but you also have the capacity to distance yourself from them. Hmm. And well, maybe not.
Well, you have to take that position as an essayist. And yeah, I mean, when you're writing about something critically, I think, yeah, that's part of it. So yeah.
Well, you're better at it than most, though.
I don't know. Yeah.
I do. So, I think so. Well, so these, I commend the other essays on Christianity. I mean, Meghan, so this one is comical to me, though. It has its dramatic side as well. The essay on Christian pop music and rock and roll. The essay on hell is one of the most remarkable pieces in the book. And your report in Harper's on Mike Pence is just fantastic, and getting into the question of what it means to be living in or supposedly living in exile, and how various churches, theologians, and political figures are using the iconic figure of Daniel, mm-hmm. to sort of decide who is serving in a just way or not. But I want to jump from those to something that sort of gets us into everyday life, which is Meghan's essay, Contemporaries. So still, we're because you are who you are, you're necessarily going to be grappling with metaphysical questions. But the opening scene here sort of draws us into something that at least begins in a less metaphysical way.
I'm going to read the opening scene. Okay. Found it. Yeah, this is kind of one of the more narrative-y pieces, where it's very like scene-based. Okay. The restaurant is the most popular in town, and we wait the better portion of an hour for a table. There are eight of us gathered on the sidewalk. It's late spring, the kind of mauve-ish, gloaming hour that Virginia Woolf would have marked by the whirling and wheeling of rooks. But there are no rooks here, just dull halos of sodium light and some small brown birds that dart among the shadows, their species unknown to us. We are hungry, and we complain to one another about people who linger at their tables. This is the problem with this town, someone says. There's nothing to do here but eat and drink, so everyone camps out at restaurants. Then our reservation is called, and we are led inside to a private room lit with tallow candles and assembled entirely of old wood. Most of us present became friends in our late 20s, and some of us are only newly acquainted. But we are the kind of people who speak easily of our internal lives, who regard most social contexts as occasions to divulge the experiences we deem most crucial to our personal development. One woman who has recently returned from New Mexico tells us about an epiphany she had in the wilderness. A year ago, she quit her job and left our town to live in a cabin in the Chihuahuan Desert, where she spent several months meditating, quote, all the time. She appears, as people always do upon returning from places of ample sunshine, brighter and more defined, her silhouette set in stark relief against the backdrop. One of the men says to her, "When you say you are meditating all the time, what does that mean?" The woman looks thoughtfully at her empty plate. "I mean it literally," she says. "I don't know how else to describe it. I did guided meditations in the morning and afternoon, and then when I wasn't sitting, I went out walking and walking meditation. And I was constantly walking and constantly meditating." After some time, she tells us, she had a revelation. The revelation was this: she needed to come back here to the city and the job she had left. She had moved to the desert because she was driven by fear. She had been fine all along. "Then I got sick," she says. "I had a horrible case of the flu. I went around in a daze for a whole week, and then I was better, and all my things were packed into my car as if by magic." Some of us have been raised by attentive and encouraging families to speak this way. For others, the skill was learned later in life, in the crucible of identity politics, in defiance of those who would prefer that they remain silent. There are only a few among us, I confess I'm one of them, who are a little embarrassed by the effusions, though in my case the aversion is mostly defensive, a reaction to the self-position I lack, self-possession I lack, and undoubtedly envy. The truth is, I love nothing so much as to hear about the hygiene of other people's souls.
What is the process one needs to take up to be attentive to the psychic hygiene of other people? And what do you hear?
Yeah, this is really true. I love hearing people talk about, you know, I would say in the broadest sense, their spiritual life. People don't usually use that phrase. But if you listen to people who are not religious at all, they're constantly talking about their spiritual lives and their spiritual development. And I do find myself talking about this a lot. I think we're very, very concerned with our, you know, our headspace and our revelations about ourselves. And I'm interested in what that means in a secular space, I guess, in, you know, a culture that doesn't have sort of the religious girding to guide that, when it's just sort of your awareness of yourself that is guiding that. I think some interesting things emerge. Something I end up talking about in this essay a lot, so I talked about the woman who was meditating, and I've tried meditation. Most of the people I know are doing some sort of, you know, trying to be present. Mindfulness, I guess, is the term, mm-hmm. like trying to be present, and this sort of obsession, which is where the title Contemporaries comes with, but the obsession with being present. Mm-hmm. And I'm interested in...
Be here now,
yeah, right? The Eckhart Tolle,
right,
yeah.
Yeah, right.
And on one hand, I understand that impulse and the idea is that technology is taking us away from being fully embodied and being fully here now. And but on the other hand, I find myself increasingly just feeling like I want to escape the present and feeling trapped in the present, and that the internet is actually the instantiation of the eternal now, right? Mm-hmm. This idea that there's this 24-hour news cycle and everything is, we have this very, you know, every day you have a serving of new minutia and news, and when you talk about something that happened on Twitter like 2 weeks ago, it's like ancient history.
Yeah.
Like, what was that? You know, what was happening 2 weeks ago? I don't know. This idea that we're kind of have this sort of ahistorical presence right now, I think, where it's really difficult to remember the past and really difficult increasingly to imagine a future.
Yeah. So let's go to we'll get there and then we'll have some time for questions, but this essay really made me think of the way contemporary life as it's expressed, whether in reality TV or various places, right, it can very much give one the feeling of an emptiness, right?
Mm-hmm.
But the emptiness there that you identify is countered by the data files that are being stored by Apple and Amazon and Google that are nothing but, I mean, they're the antithesis of empty, right? They're saving everything that they can, right? Which led to one of my favorite lines, which is, I sometimes wonder whose job it will be to weed through our digital garbage and make sense of it all.
Mm-hmm.
This is a really stunning moment. You juxtapose that, as you sort of hinted at here, against your growing up as a child and thinking of being watched by Moses and Plato in whatever you're doing, right? Like that you were in conversation, some kind of interactive conversation with people going back generations and the greatest minds that have been on the planet.
It wasn't necessarily the greatest minds on the planet. I think it was more so just the idea of perspective.
Yeah, yeah.
The idea that, like, what does this moment mean right now? You know, like, it's impossible to see what this moment means without imagining what it means in the scope of history.
Yeah,
so, like, somebody from, the past.
And how would they be perceiving it and so forth?
Right.
And you sort of put that up against the experiences you've had on the surface, either as a Christian or a consumer, which then leads to the conclusion of this essay.
Yeah, so maybe I'll read, like, the last... a few paragraphs here.
Yeah.
Okay. Throughout my 20s, I was a prolific journaler. I filled pages of Mead notebooks with self-analysis and self-diagnosis. I still have these notebooks, and when I go back and read them today, I'm struck by two things. One, how relentlessly self-aware I was. In each entry, I dissect my own faults and delusions with unflinching vigilance, circling back to each statement to offer caveats and addendums. I realize, of course, begin so many transitions, or once, don't for a second think I'm unaware. And yet the second thing that strikes me is how, despite these interrogations, I remain patently unaware of the most obvious truths about myself. Things that would be clear to any sane reader are circled and evaded with an ignorance that is almost farcical. It is as though I was capable of seeing everything except that which was most obvious, except the thing which was right in front of me. Awareness is not the same as perspective. Sometimes the former is an obstacle to the latter. A man I used to know, a pastor, once said that self-awareness was the consequence of original sin, that the first error committed in the primordial garden. Humans were once as happy as lambs, munching the grass, unaware of their minds or their bodies. It was greed that set us apart from the animals. We desired a knowledge of ourselves that was meant for God alone. It could not but doom us to unhappiness. This is, of course, the Christian view of things, that we were better off sheep. Now we are passing this curse on to the inanimate things of this world. I live in a house full of objects that are slowly becoming conscious, a thermostat, a coffee maker, a computer, a phone. Throughout the day, they watch me and blink their blue lights and silently gather information. And on some days, I believe, along with the optimists, that they will soon tell us everything we care to know about ourselves. But I do not sleep well. My dreams are rife with shadows and menace, and the house, during those hushed hours before dawn, seems to groan beneath the weight of those budding brains. Increasingly, there are nights when I sit up in bed, awakened by the panic of some half-remembered thought, one of those foundational problems that gets lost in the wash of secondary concerns and emerges only when you are loose and unguarded to remind you with a start that you've forgotten the original question, that you're missing the point. That's the end.
This is not a shameless plug for the magazine. I think the point of Meghan's writing is to courageously embark on the journey. And the way that you do that from page to page in this collection is truly remarkable. And so I commend you for it. And I would like to open the floor for questions for people who would like to know more.
I just got your joke about the point.
Yeah.
The Sorry.
Yeah.
That we're missing, we're all missing
what
the,
is point
the point in our
it's
lives.
It's a magazine. Yes. Yes. So questions.
Yes. Come around with the mic.
So I'm also late to coming to discovering my Midwesterner, partly because I grew up in Texas. but my dad's from Northern Illinois, so I came here and somebody from Wisconsin identified my accent as an Illinois accent. But I think in Texas, it also distinguishes itself from the coast in a very rebellious way, in a way of like, if you violate the coastal norms, that's a good thing. Mm-hmm. And so my perception of the Midwest is that it's kind of like we perceive whiteness as the absence of race, maleness as the absence of gender, and there's something in the Midwest in which it's that similar dynamic, as it were. So I wonder what you might say if to the idea that the Midwest is kind of, some of the stuff you talk about in Madison, what I sense is this sense that this is normal. It's an insistence on being right and embracing the normal, and if you violate that, you're somehow stepping out of line. You might see that.
Yeah, I think that's a really apt observation about the Midwest. And I, it's funny, I always think of Texas as being a great foil for somewhere that has a really distinct cultural identity. You know, that's also not coastal, but, you know, people seem like they're from Texas. They're very, like, proud to be from Texas. And I think at the Midwest, there's not so much of that. And I think part of it is that idea that we're sort of supposed to be the lowest common denominator of what it means to be American. And that often gets conflated with these categories of white, Protestant, you know, particularly, I think, after the 2016 election. There's this idea of the Midwest as a political category. It's a place where the white working class is from, even though it's much broader than that. And I have maybe to sort of speak to that idea of norms, I have an essay in here about American niceness and the idea of Midwestern nice, which is something that people often talk about, how the Midwest is, you know, so nice, and what does that actually mean? And I talk about how there's sometimes hostile undertones to that, too, that being niceness is a way of saying, like, again, nothing to see here, folks, right? Everything is fine. Everybody's normal is sort of a way to keep people at bay. I talked about different ways in which politicians sometimes use the concept of Midwestern nice to obscure racial injustice and obscure class and things like that. It's a way of creating this sort of false, cheery, democratic spirit that's a way of ignoring sort of the underlying structural problems of the region. So, yeah, that's something I would definitely agree with.
I think that then the Midwest might be hegemonic in a way? Because I'm also thinking about, like, Brokaw and Peter Jennings, they adopt Midwestern accents. And
yeah, there is a sense, I mean, and I think that's sort of, that's part of the
I've
legacy.
I've always felt hegemonic, personally.
You felt hegemonic?
Yes. Very.
Well, people forget too that like places like Ferguson, Missouri, and Flint and Detroit that are predominantly non-white populations are in the Midwest. That gets obscured and that gets left out because there is this myth of the Midwest being this white middle class. You know, if we want to create this, sustain this myth that we're a predominantly white nation, I think it's really important that the Midwest, which is supposed to be the most American place in America, we sustain that myth and forget about sort of the other cultures that live here. You know, I grew up not far from Dearborn, Michigan, which is the largest Arab American population in the United States. People don't think about that as the Midwest, but that is part of our story. So I guess my hope would be that more that changes and that there's more awareness that this isn't just a hegemonic place. Yeah.
Hey, Meghan, thanks for coming.
Yeah.
So I'm really intrigued by this American niceness that you guys were just talking about. What was it for you that you kind of came into this knowing that it was a more blandness, more of a defensive strategy, like a defensive culture, versus like a kind sort of vibe or aesthetic? What made you aware of that darker side of niceness?
Well, I guess that piece grew out, it was actually, I should say more about
it's
that
review,
piece.
Right?
It was a review of a book, which I would highly recommend by Carrie Tirado Brownman, who wrote a book called American Niceness. And she doesn't write about the Midwest. She's just writing about the idea of niceness in American culture. And on one hand, it seemed like it was this horrible timing because the book came out in early 2017, right after Trump got elected. And, nice is not, I think, whatever our legacy is going to be in the future of this era. It's not going to be American niceness, right? But it was actually a very relevant book for this era, I think, because she talks about how niceness and nastiness are two sides of the same coin and how they basically sustain one another. And so she goes back and talks about, this idea of, like, American innocence. So when, after 9/11 happened, George Bush said the main question is, like, well, why do they hate us? This idea, like, how,
right,
totally obscuring our history in the Middle East, how could these people hate? We're good,
right,
decent, nice,
right,
nice people. What do they have against us? She traces this all the way back. A lot of her book takes place in the 19th century. So in writing about this book and thinking about that sort of dynamic of niceness and nastiness, I was thinking about how in the Midwest particularly, Midwestern niceness functions, and I talked, I was at the time actually writing this essay about Mike Pence that appeared in Harper's, and so I've been just watching hours and hours of Mike Pence speeches, which I don't recommend to anybody. But one of his most famous appearances was after the Restoration of Religious Freedom Act was enacted in Indiana, which is a law that he enacted as the governor of Indiana. Saying that businesses and florists and bakers could refuse business, basically could discriminate to people on the basis of sexual identity. And he was on the air with George Stephanopoulos, is like this famous interview, and George Stephanopoulos said, like, how are you justifying this ability to discriminate against people? And he said, you know, George, he said, Hoosiers, this is the quote, Hoosiers don't believe in discrimination. Anybody that's been in Indiana for 5 minutes knows that Hoosier hospitality is not a slogan, it's a reality. People tell me when I travel around this country, gosh, I went to your state and people are so nice. You know, so this idea of, in a way, it was this very politically deaf move, which was not addressing the question, but just saying, we're nice, we couldn't possibly be discriminating against people. And that was something that I don't agree with as a politics, but I really identified with that move as a Midwesterner, I think, sort of deflecting this very difficult political issue by saying, oh no, I'm a nice person. And I don't know if that's particular necessarily to the Midwest, but I think maybe there is sort of this larger trend on the left where we talk a lot about like openness and sort of this, almost this, as though it's a matter of affect, you know, that we're open, we're not, you know, discriminatory, we're loving, we're, you know, caring, engaged
to
people.
That.
Right, yeah. Yeah, but then like not talking about the actual structural political
right.
issues that underlie that, you know, and it is a way of, I think, avoiding talking about those structural issues.
Yeah,
so.
In one way or the other, it's the absence of engagement, right? It's
yeah.
the absence of sort of recognition
yeah.
of personhood or of something beyond, it, you know, if you bring nice and nasty together, nasty isn't even like well thought out meanness,
mm-hmm.
you know, it's just nasty.
Mm-hmm.
So it's sort of the absence of reckoning with.
Yeah, it is. It's a way of sort of gliding over
yeah.
the issue. And I guess the personal, maybe to answer the question about the personal, is that something that I hadn't really thought about deeply until I started writing about this book, and then was forced to maybe think about the ways in which that functions in my own life, you know. And I talk in the end about how, you know, it's particularly, I think, common among people my age to say like, oh, you know, yeah, we live in this ugly nation and we're, you know, imperialist and racist, but we're the good people because, you know, we buy fair trade coffee and we, you know, use the right pronouns and everything. And this is, again, this sort of very surface level sort of niceness that I think is eliding the deeper issues, yeah.
Other questions?
Yeah. Yeah, that is interesting because it's one of those terms that's, I think, for me, seems like it's very aligned with the pastoral idea of the Midwest, sort of this very idyllic small town America, the heartland. I think there was a, wasn't the Sarah Smarsh book that came out called Heartland? Was that what it was called?
There was
a memoir that came out that was also about her experience growing up kind of in the working class, white working class family, I want to say in Nebraska, that was called Heartland. And yeah, I don't know if you hear, that's a term that you hear a lot in political commentary, it seems to me. And it does seem very coded, increasingly. And then, yeah, advertisements, right? Like Chevy truck commercials, I think. Yeah. And yeah, so maybe there's political connotations there. I don't know, but yeah, to me, that is maybe. I would hope that a lot of the essays in the book maybe problematize that conception of the Midwest, or at least try to move beyond it. Yeah, that's a great question.
If Nebraska has anything to do about it, maybe the heartland. It's not for everyone.
It's not for everyone.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, that's sorry, I just want to say that phrase, that motto is like the perfect example of Midwestern nice being vaguely hostile, right? It's like weird, like Midwestern pseudo humility, but
right.
sort of also like,
yeah.
it's not, we don't want, yeah, like vaguely hostile, maybe xenophobic, I don't know, but yeah.
I'll try to avoid my Boston stories.
I have the mic here, thanks.
Yes.
So thank you so much for your comments. We have a lot in common, so I've been sitting here nodding, and I'm really looking forward to reading the book. I was born in Detroit, grew up in Grand Rapids and going to a cottage north of Muskegon.
Oh, great. Mm.
And I went to UW-Madison and now live in Oshkosh. So I'm traversing the cultural differences on a weekly basis and work for the university, but live in a blue-collar family now that I married into in Oshkosh. So I have kind of two parts to a related question. You can answer whatever piece you'd like to, but I'm wondering on the faith side how you've navigated your family relationships and managed that, and you no longer live in Muskegon. So I'm also wondering, did you move back to Madison because that didn't feel like home anymore, or how you navigate those types of complex cultural differences within the Midwest?
Oh, yeah. Maybe I'll answer the second one first because that one's easy. My husband got a tenure track job here, so that's why we moved back. But that's the easiest way of describing why we moved back. But I do think I feel a lot more comfortable in Madison than I did back, you know, going back to the year we lived in Michigan. We were just we moved there because we were like in a lot of debt and we're trying to save money. We're still in a lot of debt, so buy my book. But we...
Buy my book. It's not for everyone.
Yeah. Right? It's not for everyone, yeah. But we do, it was hard there because a lot of people, I had grown up with had either left that town or they had like many children. And I don't know, it was interesting going back there. We were kind of isolated and didn't like have a good community there. We have a great community here in Madison. I guess maybe that could lead into the second question about my relationship with my family. So yeah, I actually did a reading in Ann Arbor there in the Detroit area and was back there like the middle of October. And they had read the book. And they hadn't really read much of my writing before then. And so we got to talk about it, which is interesting. But our relationship...
It wouldn't necessarily be surprising given where you've published. I mean, N plus one and
right. So the magazines weren't publishing. I had never heard of. We didn't subscribe to like the New Yorker or Harper's when I was growing up. You know, we had Christianity Today and World Magazine, which I don't know if that's still around.
Another check. Yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
So I think my trajectory with my family is that I was like kind of estranged from them when I first left Christianity, and there was a lot of difficult conversations that we had around that, and part of the difficulty was that I wasn't able at that time to fully articulate the reasons why I was leaving and sort of the theological problems I was struggling with. And so it was interesting. Over the years, I've sort of repaired a relationship with them, and I'm pretty close with my family today. I go back to Michigan quite a lot, and we've kind of agreed like not to talk about a lot of these things, but then they read the book. So we had a conversation about it, and it was pretty good. They, I don't know, they said that they felt like they understood a little bit more of my story that they hadn't totally understood before. So I don't know, maybe in some subconscious level, I think I was writing this book to explain myself to my parents, maybe, and it's, of course, never satisfying because they didn't, you know, say, you were right. And we still have, like, many disagreements about just very basic things, different worldviews. But I think the beautiful thing is that we're able to still have a relationship and get along quite well despite that. Yeah.
Not to drive this discussion ideas down to a semantic debate or query, but as we're talking, we're like, okay, now where is the Midwest, or what is the Midwest, mm-hmm. and what is your definition? Because I, what came to mind is speaking of the New Yorker, the classic cover where it's the New Yorker's map of the country, and it's like very, very high resolution, up to the Hudson River, and then it's
it's like Manhattan.
and then there's like the Mississippi River and the Pacific Ocean.
It's a little blurry.
Right. And
Los Angeles,
it gets blurry
in
between.
Right.
And so it's like the Midwest could be anything from the Alleghenies to the Rockies, mm-hmm. or so what are we talking about?
Yeah, this is actually, I learned, a very fiercely contested thing. I always thought that the Midwest was pretty clear.
notion. I went to a Midwestern conference. I think it was like the Society for the Study of Midwestern Literature, which is held every year. It was at Michigan State University, and we got into a big debate there with this panel that I was on, because there was one guy who had come from Nebraska, and he insisted that Nebraska and the Dakotas were not part of the Midwest. They were the Plains states.
Plains, right.
Yeah. But then there is this, I think it's like the 11th state. This was the classic, like the 11th state definition of, or maybe it's the 13th state definition. And it includes the Dakotas. Sorry, this gets really wonky. But there's people, yeah, who are thinking about
this.
Does
it now include New Jersey because Rutgers is in the Big Ten?
No, I don't think New Jersey in any definition.
I was thinking it might shoo at least Piscataway. Isn't
it? No, not everything is about sports.
No.
So what is your definition?
Of the Midwest?
Yeah, that you're writing about when you say.
Like which states Midwest. Are included?
Which states and or which states of mind?
Well, I should clarify, most of...
This is your chance, Meghan. No.
Michigan, Illinois. <Yeah. laughs> You can list them all. Yeah, most of my experience has been in the upper Midwest, which is Wisconsin, Michigan. I've never lived in Minnesota. I lived in Illinois for a while. One of the essays about Pence, I went to Indiana. You know, he's an Indiana politician. I consider him Midwestern. You know, Missouri, the Dakotas, Iowa.
Ohio,
yeah.
Iowa. Yeah, we said that.
I draw the line at Pennsylvania. That's always sort of...
So you did not... Yeah, Penn State doesn't count.
I don't think
just
so.
Just make... Okay, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, I went to Pittsburgh last year, too, and they said that they considered themselves the back door of the East Coast. That's where they consider themselves that west of there is the Midwest.
Yeah.
Which you could maybe make a case for. Yeah.
Yeah. Other questions? We have time for one more for sure. And then Lauren, you after, yeah. We'll get
mine's a little different.
Okay.
Because I read the intro to this meeting from the Cap Times article.
Oh yeah.
So the states didn't mean anything to me. It's just, but was your fall away from the Lord. That's what clued me to be here tonight. And it's nice that you can, you know, believe whatever you want to believe, but there comes a point in your life where you got to make a decision. And a week ago Monday, I was at the Carbone Cancer Clinic, and the urologist told me, he says, "You know what, John? You're young, and you're going to die of prostate cancer." And it's nice to philosophize about a lot of things in life, but everybody here is going to die someday. And when the doctor tells you that, it's a little bit more reality than all that we're talking about here. So I was wondering, if I were to tell you, you know, you've got X amount of time to live, and the doctor was nice to me because I have prostate cancer, he said, "You're going to die of this, but you may live 10 years."
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's a lot of different people here. A story at UW where it can be as short as 2 weeks. I've heard stories like that. How would you take the philosophy of where you are today, and would you change it? Would you? Because right now I don't really know what you believe or where you're going.
If I was to die tomorrow. I used to do street evangelism. I know this tactic.
We thought we might have an altar call at the end, but
it's a good question. Yeah, that there's maybe like more. If you had a larger sense of urgency, would that change what I believed? Yeah, it's interesting because a lot of the ideas that I'm writing about, things that I really struggled with as a believer, like you know the problem of evil, the problem of hell. I've since found satisfying answers for those by reading maybe more liberal theologians or reading sort of a wider, you know, swath of theology where I sometimes wonder like, well, if I had encountered that response when I was younger, would that have kept me in? And it's like, well, now I know that answer, so why can't I go back in, you know? And I think it is true that it's not enough to know intellectually the answers, you have to have some sort of experience. You know, you have to have the same way that you have a conversion experience or a deconversion experience. It can be about all of these logical reasons, or you can say it's about logical, rational reasons, but usually it's about some sort of emotional underlying thing, a need. I need to believe this, or I need not to. So I don't know. If I if I ever change what I believe, I imagine it would be from something like that. Maybe if I get cancer, I don't know, or something dramatic. But yeah, I think that's interesting to think about, is what are those sort of underlying emotional sparks that create these bridges or these sort of conversions and deconversions in our lives.
Which we didn't address, but is engaged in the book in a number of different ways. So
yeah.
Just there's more there.
Hello.
Yeah.
Hi.
So about like an
last
hour and
question.
A half ago, yes,
yeah.
Last question. We started the conversation and you were talking about having a sense of existential dizziness in the Midwest with technology coming out of the West and politics in the East, and having this sense of like, oh, I'm probably supposed to be somewhere else and I'm probably going to leave, but you're still here and you're probably not leaving.
Mm-hmm.
I hope
do
not.
You
if I get the opportunity, I'll go. I don't like the winter, but yeah.
I just think it's interesting because your descriptions of the Midwest aren't especially flattering, and I think we would all agree with that, but we're all still here in the Midwest, and
mm-hmm.
we laugh at them, and we think it's kind of charming at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
What, like, why are you still here, and what do you think it is about the Midwest that, in general, makes it very hard for people to leave, even when we feel like we need to leave?
Yeah.
And do you feel like your sense of needing to leave has stopped or has lessened?
That's a good question. Yeah, I do have a lot of, I would say, I think the word that's always used in reviews of the book is like ambivalence, that I have a lot of ambivalence about the Midwest, which I think is probably true. It's not somewhere where if you had asked me at the age of, you know, 15, like, well, how do you see your life? I definitely didn't think it was going to be in the Midwest. And I guess my reason for not leaving seems very accidental, maybe, is that, you know, I just, like, couldn't get my life together in a way to go somewhere else. I never had the opportunity to. And it's also, I think, you know, right now it's financially very easy to live in the Midwest. I think maybe if I were growing up in the 80s or even in the 90s, this idea where you can go be a bohemian in New York City and you can do that and scrape by and make a name for yourself, I think that's increasingly difficult to do as a freelance writer with no connections to anybody on the East Coast. So I think in many ways my staying here feels like it was accidental. But now that I've been here for so long, it has become such a deep part of my identity. I think it'd be hard to leave. You know, and I fantasize about it sometimes. Like I have, you know, friends who've moved to California and I think, oh my gosh, that'd be so great to just be in the sun all the time and eat fresh avocados all year. But then like, what am I, like I've built this whole, I have this whole sensibility, like I just feel like that would be like cheating or something, you know? And I have these sort of like intellectual concerns that have grown out of being here and being sort of in a place that feels outside of the centers of culture. And I think a lot of the sensibilities that come out in my essay is this sense of being sort of outside of that world, and that there's a value in sort of having that critical distance from those places where a lot of the news and the culture comes from. So I think there is something I've come to value about the region that maybe unexpectedly and despite myself.
We're grateful that you're close by and that hopefully this won't be the last time you're here with us presenting and or reading, and we're just delighted that you were willing to spend one more evening talking about this book.
Yeah, thanks so much for having me, and thanks for the wonderful questions too.
Yes,
really
can we
great.
Give Meghan a hand?